Okay, we are demonstrating a TURP today in a large gland. Basically, a median lobe it appears to be. So, let us have a cystoscopy and then understand how big is the gland. This is a classical draping of a patient with the penis exposed and the proficial skin withdrawn and a gauze piece around in the corona and a possibility to do a rectal examination in case if it is necessary intraoperatively. Other thing is I was always say about the placing of these cords and these structures here. Majority of the times most of them are looping down and causing a lot of weight onto your hands. So first thing is you should be able to understand which one should come first, which one to come last. You should understand this thing, what is there. This is going to be the least mobile structure. So this should come and the first onto the patient so that we don't need to move this more and more and more and more. So this is going to be the least mobile. That's going to be fixed portion. So let it be on it. The second thing is going to be the highest weight. That is going to be the light cord. Majority of the people loop it like this, which is not needed. The light cord is always in the top like this. So it can be placed onto the abdomen of the patient and let it stay here. It doesn't need. It needs to come here. It doesn't need to come towards you. It adds to the weight of the patient, weight onto the thing. The third thing is going to be the light camera. This is a camera which is a pendulous lightweight camera which is attached to the cystoscope, and mostly it should be there onto the side where the camera processor is there. It should not be crossing and going like this. The last one is going to be the diathermy cable. Most of the time, if the diathermy cable, I keep it onto the other side. If I am a right-hander, I am working with my right-handed instrument, I will keep this cable onto the other side so that it doesn't come. This is a bipolar cable with two things. So I don't want this to be there on the right side so that my handle comes in the way of these cables. So they have to be placed here. So placing these things acrossly is going to be one of the important points when you are doing a TURP. So now we are going to do a cystoscopy, which is understanding the urethral anatomy before we do a TURP. So let us understand the anatomy of the urethra and the prostate in this patient. So another point is, before we start, we need to understand how much is the meatal size of the meatus. So this is a meatal dilator. We understand that there is a meatus which is of how much size it has come to up to this. So the size of the meatus is around 9 hega. That comes to 27 French. I am trying to pass a 26 sheath. So artery forceps. So I just want to do a small meatotomy by making a small ventral meatotomy, which is adequate enough to pass a, right, that's a meatus which is adequate enough now. That's a meatus which is adequate, yes, that's a 10 hegar, so 30 French easily passable. So now I pass a little amount of xylocaine jelly to do a cystoscopy. So I'm doing a cystoscopy now. That's a cystoscopy being done. And that's a urethra, normal, penoscrotal junction, bulb. And that's a verumontanum here. And then a large median lobe blocking. Oh, I need to push the, this is the large median lobe coming into the way. See this? Suddenly you enter into a cavity and you will not be able to see the ureteric orifices also very clear. That's a left, right ureteric orifice. That's a right ureteric orifice. And that's a left ureteric. See this? This is the median lobe which is covering the trigone significantly. That's a median lobe. That's a median lobe there. That's a median lobe. And a grade 2 lateral lobes. Two touching in between. A little overlap, not much, but a little overlap. And grade 2 lateral lobes. And that is the sphincteric area, you can see, and I can identify the sphincter area by this groove and that ring like appearance here. Then that's a verumontanum, and there's some amount of gland extending right just next to the verumontanum or a little beyond verumontanum. So that is the thing, and I've done assessment of the prostate, and the assessment of the bladder is being done, which shows a little trabeculated bladder and understanding the rest of the bladder has to be done to rule out any tumor or any other pathology. It appears to be normal. Okay, now I'll go ahead by passing a resectoscope. The resectoscope can be passed under vision with a visual obturator, which is the most commonly to be the thing to be done. So I'm going to change visual obturator a little more xylocaine jelly to see that you pass it without any difficulty. Visual obturator is placed already, and this is the resectoscope with a visual obturator. I have passed my scope into the and empty the bladder now. Okay, so I'll make my working element into it. Attach a drain tube to a continuous irrigation, which I am attaching here. Yeah. Okay. So my diathermic cable in place. Now we are planning a resection. It's a continuous irrigation working element, so I don't need to empty it unless there is a tube, unless something is blocking me. And that's a assessment of the prostate. And this is the sphincter area, which starts at the distal end of the prostate right up to this area. This all is a sphincter. Sphincter is not only a ring. It is an area extending from a smooth muscle sphincter, extending right from this area, just above the veromontanum, down to proximal bulb. So this amount is the end length. This is the length of the external sphincteric area. So retaining this amount of this smooth muscle and including this skeletal muscle in deep into this mucosa is necessary to create good continence. Don't ever think that the sphincter lies only in this ring which is seen here. It starts from this area down to this area. So if you see a contraction like this, see that is the area. This is by stopping the saline and starting the saline, you'll see that contraction. That is a rough estimate of how much is the sphincter length. So this is the median lobe, not flat, but it's a vascular median lobe, and that is the lateral lobes on either side. So identifying the ureteric area, this is the ureter on the left side, and this is the ureter on the right side. So now we are going to resect this median part of lobe, and then it starts on a 5 o'clock and a 7 o'clock position. You start resecting the thing and reach the bladder neck. You see the bladder neck muscle fibers there. So I have taken 3, and you start seeing these fibers here, which are nothing but bladder neck fibers. These are bladder neck fibers. The same thing I start doing it on the other side. I didn't found that that vessel which usually comes at that area around 5 o'clock or 7 o'clock. So on either side, this side also I have started looking at the bladder neck fibers. See this? This is the bladder neck fibers. So this is what is going to be a median lobe between the two grooves what we created. And if we find that vessel, we are going to coagulate that vessel and have a devascularized median lobe on either side. So it's a devascularized median lobe which can be resected easily. So this is a median lobe which is being resected, which is devascularized and being resected. It's a bipolar TURP, so you can see that corona which comes and cuts the tissue. It is not the thermal energy, but the corona which dissipates, and it cuts the tissue when we are doing a cutting current. And that is the median lobe, completion of the median lobe and exposure of the bladder neck fibers at this level. And the exposure of the bladder neck at this level. See, the median lobe is almost done, and you are able to take out the tissue, whatever is there in the median lobe portion, and exposing whatever you call it, bladder neck at proximally, and a surgical capsule distally. How do you know that you have reached the surgical capsule? You start seeing an arborization of the vessels, flat vessels running all across the prostate. You see this? These are flat vessels which are running across. That is the area when you say that you have reached the capsule. Once you see those flat vessels running across, you will stop resecting, and you understand that you have reached the surgical capsule automatically. and it doesn't have that woolly tissue appearance at all. So that is a surgical capsule which is being exposed in the floor of the prostatic urethra. That's the floor of the prostatic urethra and which is exposed. So you can see the bladder neck fibers which are there. There are some ridges, some elevations and depressions. Doesn't matter. That can be taken care of at the end. That is called toileting of the prostatic fossa. And this is some bleeders which are there in the prostatic fossa, which can be taken care of by point to point. Don't rub the loop all across onto the prostatic urethra. Just take a point to coagulation of the tissue of the vessels. So now, having done this, the median lobe is taken away. That eases off the flow into the bladder very easily. The flow into the bladder becomes easy. Okay. Now the next thing is going to be resection of the lateral lobes. This is the median commissure, and this is going to be the lateral lobe, and this is going to be the lateral lobe. What is going to be the, if you are a beginner, always mark where you have to end it. I'll show you again after emptying it. Come down. I'm just emptying because I want to make your vision clear. Nothing more than that. Okay. So what I'm trying to do now, I'll show you how to see. Suppose if you see that this is going to be the sphincter, and your gland is extending right up to this point. If you are a beginner, you have a marking. This is the point where I have to stop. I should not go beyond this. This is the point where I should stop. This is the way you can mark it. See this? You have an adequate around a centimeter length of mucosa or possibly even the muscle above that area. So this is the marking which you can do and say that I should not be cutting anything beyond this point. This is just distal to the verumontanum. The same thing what you are seeing here, when it comes to the roof, it should be a little proximal, because the external sphincter extends a little distally in the proximal area. So a little proximally in that area, so it should go a little more proximal. So retain a little more length in the dorsum, and you can come down towards you in the ventral area. So majority of the times, this is the point where we need to stop. So we made a marking already. So now we are going to start a resection. How do you start a resection? There are many ways of doing a resection. I do my way, usually which I do is Nesbitt's way. Is I create a groove at 11 o'clock and a 1 o'clock position. This is a groove being created in the 11 o'clock position. This is a groove being created. And once you start making a groove and march towards the capsule, you will see a vessel which is going to supply, which gets exposed. And that vessel need to be, this is a vessel which is going to be exposed, possibly got coagulated now, which need to be coagulated at that time. So this is the bladder neck fibers, and this is a possibly the surgical capsule at this area, which is already exposed. That means I have reached my limit of resection. I should not be resecting further. Having reached my limit of resection, there are two ways. Either I proceed further here like this, go on extending it and leaving this lobe centrally devascularized, or if the lobe is smaller, the other way of doing it is, otherwise doing it, going on resecting it sidewards. Start resecting it sidewards. The first bite will go near to the capsule on that side. Okay, the first bite goes near to the capsule, and then the second bite comes to the next and come parallelly. So it is going on from above downwards. You start resecting the tissue. You know where the capsule ends, so you start resecting the tissue. This is a completely debulked tissue, debulked gland on the right side. So you have debulked. Even now, you have not reached the capsule in all the areas. You have debulked the gland, which is there between the bladder neck towards the apex. But you left a significant amount of gland at the apex. See, this is the apical gland. So I always do my resection in two steps. One step is from the bladder neck till probably two-thirds of the gland, two-thirds of this area, and the rest of the one-third is along with the apex. So by which you will have a better control in saving the apex and tissue near the apex and saving the sphincter and not injuring the sphincter. So I have done a debulking of the gland in the upper two-thirds of the prostatic area, upper two-thirds of the length. Suppose if there is a 4 cm length of the prostatic urethra, I have done the first 2.5 cm above. That first 2.5 cm is over, and the next 1.5 centimeter which lies between this area till this area is remaining. So I've done the first debulking, which is there. I have not reached the capsule at every point, but I have done a great debulking here. Significant debulking has have happened. I don't want to reach the capsule immediately. Any inadvertent entry into the capsule now will hamper the whole procedure. So I don't want to reach the capsule. I have said I have done a great debulking, but the capsule is yet to be exposed. So I will do it at the end. I don't want to do that it now, at this moment. So after that, I will do the rest of the debulking from this area till this area. So that time I will start resecting it. So this is the last one third of it, distal one third. Some chips are blocking my. Okay. So now what I am seeing is the tissue. The tissue is between from here and here. So this last one third of the prostate I am going to resect now. So I have done the first two thirds. Last one third I am going to resect. The whole thing is going to be in the same page, same, the proximal two-thirds and the distal two-thirds are in the same level of resection. So idea is not to come to the capsule at every point immediately. Debulk the tissue whatsoever, create a cavity there. First create a good cavity. As a beginner, don't bother about the capsule initially. Create a good cavity initially, and then at the end you reach the capsule at all the places. So I've debulked the tissue now. I've not reached the capsule. This is the apical resection what I'm trying to do. Till the area of my first marking, what I have done, which I have already done now. Till my first area of marking, which I am trying to do. So at present, I see multiple vessels which come through the into the prostate, which I don't think is needed to be coagulated. Debulk everything and then start doing the coagulation. There is no point independently coagulating at every point. You will be wasting time and energy in coagulating every tissue. So this is what is the debulking part which has happened. Now that's a part which is there at this area. So having done the debulking, you can see that the whole part is debulked. Having done the debulking, this is the edge where I made a marking there. Having done the debulking completely, so now I need to reach the capsule on the right side. How do I need to reach the capsule? This is the first cut I have made, and the same place I will go now. Same place I go and I reach the capsule at every point. So this is the point, and that is the vessel which I will encounter in the 11 o'clock position. Okay. I start resecting this completely. You make a cut. See, you have seen a simple way is, you have seen the capsule here. I have seen the capsule here. So once I see the capsule here, you know where is the end, where is the level, what is the level. This is the level of capsule. So there is an adenoma. Make a cut. You create a ridge on the other side. You could divide that ridge. It will expose the capsule here and make one more ridge on the other side. So you start resecting that independently now. So that's how. So it's basically, 1 minute, I'll just empty. Basically creating a ridge and then cutting it. I think there is a bleeder somewhere. Let me coagulate that and then I can show them. Yes. So this is the 11 o'clock position and this is the capsule what we saw. So basically what we need to do, cut this ridge. Expose the capsule here. This is a capsule which is exposed, and now cut this ridge which is formed on the other side. Now cut this ridge. So you start making a ridge, cut the ridge and making another ridge next to it and start moving towards the capsule. So this way you will not be in a hurry to injure or cut the capsule immediately. Or injuring the capsule immediately. As you near to the capsule, you will see this perforator vessels which are coming in, which is can be coagulated. So same ridge again we are going to cut. We have a good control. See that you are seeing the capsular area all the time on either side. See that you are seeing the capsular area on either side. That's a capsular area on either side. So half loop will be the best way to know how much depth you are taking care of. Don't take the loop. Don't take the chip completely in the loop, only half. See that? That's a half loop. You know how much depth you are. Right. So this is how you can start creating a ridge and then cut the ridge, a groove will be formed and the ridge is formed. You create a groove here and the next the ridge is formed. You create a groove here by cutting this, the ridge is formed next door. So that's how you will be reaching the capsule in all directions. Have a control when the need, when your instrument or the loop is moving towards you. Have a control and a significant control on your hand. Don't be in a hurry to cut it. Don't coagulate generously. You just pinpoint coagulation is necessary. Too much of coagulation at every place is not advisable. That in fact produces more necrotic tissue and causes of a secondary bleeding are going to be more high. People coming after 10 days after bleeding is basically because of this necrotic tissue which is generated, gets sloughed away and it separates from the capsule and that produces the bleeding. These air bubbles which are formed at every cut here are the product of a bipolar coagulation. This will not be seen in mostly in monopolar, but it's quite common in bipolar resections. That's it. So what has happened till now? We have finished the right lobe, almost up to the capsule. Maybe there are small areas which are not yet to be done, which will be taken care of at the end again. That's called toileting. So the right lobe is complete. Right lobe is complete. Let me empty. So coming to the left lobe now. I don't want to go into the small toileting which I need to do now. See this? This is the tissue which I want to preserve at the end of resection. This is a sphincter thing seen and that's a lesser sphincter seen. So that needs to be done. And this is a small tissue which is hanging, which is of the right lobe, which I am going to resect. There's a lot of tissue in the roof which I'll decide whether to resect or not to resect at the end of the resection. Usually I'll leave that area between the 11 and 1 to the last. If the tissue is more, I'll resect. If the tissue is not much, I'll not resect. Now I think I'm resecting that tissue. There's a lot of tissue. That's a capsular there and the other side is going to be this much. So I'm going to resect that tissue also. I started at 1 or 12 o'clock position now and then resecting into the deep at that area to expose that 11 o'clock bleeder which supplies. That's a bleeder there. That's actually the bleeder which is supplying there and we are going to coagulate that point. And now you start moving from the capsular area. From the capsular area to the center. To the center. And resect the gland. So upper half is over. So the same bleeder which got opened again. Possibly I have not reached the capsule completely at that point. Yes, okay. And again I will resect the capsule and go to the medial aspect of it and resect that gland which is hanging in the center of the urethra. See, that is the point. That is the point. Again I go to the capsule. Come down to the capsule lower level. At the lower level, I know that is the capsule which is getting exposed every time. And then come towards the center. So you start directing from, you started at 1 o'clock, you resected then the 2 o'clock area, 3 o'clock area, 4 o'clock area, and then start coming towards the center. So having done that, you have deworked the most of the gland which is there in the urethra. Most of the gland has been resected. Let me empty this for a better visual. What is happening? Again, see this, the last one third of the urethra of the prostate I am not going to touch. The first proximal two thirds I am going to be resecting. I started off with at a 1 o'clock position exposing this bleeder which is bleeding now. Yes, that is the bleeder. And most of these mega bleeders are always at the junction of the prostate gland and the bladder neck and the bladder muscle. This is the bladder muscle which is already exposed and at the junction between the bladder muscle and the prostate gland. Right. So the first cut again goes down to next to the capsule. And then come to the center and take out the tissue Immediately you start resecting and taking out the tissue. After done that, again you go back to the capsular area. Next to the capsule you make a cut, expose the capsule again and start cutting towards the midline and debulk the tissue. At one point of the time you have done a lot of debulking of the tissue. Again next to the capsule. And debulking. See the vessels anywhere? Yes, again that vessel is open. Okay. Okay, by this time you have done a fair amount of debulking and what is left behind is only what is the tissue inside the apex. So you start resecting this apical tissue now. You know where you need to end. This is the point where you cannot go beyond. So you will be concentrating on that area. See that your tissue, your cut doesn't extend that more than that and start resecting that tissue. So debulking of the gland in the proximal one third is happened. Debulking of the gland in the distal one third is happening now, and the tissue just next to the in the apical area in front of the sphincter is being resected now. Don't let your scope come back. That will let your loop come over onto the sphincter area. So fix the scope. It is only rotation of the scope which should matter, not movement of the scope inside and outside, which should be happening now. It should never happen at this point of time. Again, same thing. You start at one point, create a groove, look at a ridge which is created next to it, and again resect it. Look at a groove here, next ridge created, again resect it. So in that way, you will be debulking stepwise from one point to other point. So I think I have resected the apex also. Let me empty and see again. So the thing is, what you look at is a sphincter area. This is a sphincter area with the lissosphincter, that is a smooth muscle sphincter, which is being covered very well there. So again, I am resecting that area near the apex from top to bottom. So debulking of the whole thing has happened. And this is the apical thing which is being debulked. So by this time, I think I have resected all the amount, debulked the tissue. Suppose somebody gets into a problem at this point of time and you take out the scope and finish the procedure also, then also it's okay. But rest of the job, there may be a lot of adenomatous tissue still existing in the fossa, which will be seen very clearly at this point of time. So those things, what you require is going to be is toileting. That means you start resecting all this extra adenoma what is seen at the end of the saw. So you have done a great debulking, you have done finished completely. The debulking is over. Even if you stop the procedure, the patient will be very happy regarding passage of urine is concerned. But now the adenoma is being taken away. This is called toileting of the prosthetic fossa, wherein you take out all that small remnants of the adenomatous tissue on the capsule. Here and there is a small tissue pieces which are extra projections which are there as adenoma being taken away. That's called toileting of prosthetic fossa. I've exposed the capsule at many places now, right from here. I have exposed the capsule already. This is all exposed capsule here. But some areas, see this? This is a loose adenomatous tissue. So that I am excising now, again exposing the capsule. So wherever there is a small tissues like this, will be taken out. This is called toileting of the prosthetic fossa. Makes the toiletic for this prosthetic fossa very smooth and clean, and looks at the hemostasis also at that point of time. See, this is the capsular tissue which is already exposed. I don't need to see anymore. See this? This is adenomatous tissue, so I am just excising and keeping it. You will see that movement happening inside the capsular area. Once you start moving, see that movement, don't cut any further. That movement itself will cause the capsular contraction and causes perforation of the capsule. See this? This is nothing but capsule where you can see the arborization of the blood vessels under it. You'll see a horizontally placed blood vessels under it. That's called capsule. That is going to be seen in capsule. This small amount of tissue is just above the bladder neck area. So you excise and expose the capsule or the peripheral zone of the prostate in a better fashion. Right. And this is the verumontanum and a small tissue in front of the verumontanum there, which is exposed. Keep the verumontanum intact and expose the tissue. There will be some amount of bleeders all around the verumontanum. There will be a significant bleeders. Most of the time the bleeding is very, very tenacious there and sometimes irritates also. It doesn't settle, it doesn't stop very easily sometimes. You don't need to worry. Majority of these bleeders don't really trouble you in the postoperative period. Majority of them will close down the moment you put a catheter. See that? That is the verumontanum and that is a mucosal bleeding. That's mostly mucosal bleeders which are going to be there at that point of time. So I've done the finish the right side completely. Now I'll look at the toileting of the left side. First thing is look at the hemostasis. The majority of the hemostasis are problems, postoperative problems, immediate postoperative bleedings are happening because of the vessels left in the roof of the prostatic fossa. So beware and have some time to coagulate all the vessels in the roof, because these are the things which cause bleeding in the postoperative fissure. So the roof is clear now. I checked the roof completely. Now I look at the tissues which is there, some small tissue pieces or tissue attachments which are there in the prostatic fossa for something called toileting. This is what is toileting. Small bait chips which will expose. See, this is the capsular area, very well seen. This is the capsule which is very well seen. Small adenomatous tissue, chip it up, and this is small adenomatous tissue, chip it up and expose the capsule. So this is called toileting of the prostatic fossa. This gives you a smooth surface of the prostatic fossa and it looks very nice to look at. Also, you'll have a create a nice good, that's it. Most of the time, then the prostatic fossa looks very, very open in a distended bladder. You should always assess the resection or possibility of the way the fossa appears only in a half distended bladder. So, at the end of resection, always, when you see that you have done, like now I felt that I have done a fairly decent job and there is hardly any prostatic tissue left behind for me to resect. What all is there is only a capsular tissue. I don't want to do any more resection, especially in the top. And I see that I preserved all the sphincter and the smooth muscle around the sphincter, smooth muscle and the mucosal lining over the sphincter very well. There are some bleeders which are always seen here, but don't be a tendency to coagulate them. That will definitely damage the muscle fibers below. So don't bother about those vessels. I've done a complete resection, I feel. So what I'll do is, I'll empty this bladder and see whether I've done it completely or not. Let me see it, right? I'm emptying this bladder, half, semi-empty the bladder and see whether it looks, there's some tissue still. Okay, this is a collapsing mucosa around the sphincter area. See that? You still feel there is some ridge. Oh, come on, there is some tissue which never appeared. This is what happens when you have an over distended bladder and you assess the prostatic fossa. You never saw the tissue like this when your bladder was over distended. So your assessment should happen only when there is a half distension of the bladder, not as a complete distension of the bladder. It gets a half resected prostatic fossa gets stretched so much that you'll see that you'll feel that as if there's no tissue. See this, there's so much of tissue here. But don't be over jealous in resecting it. Sometimes even the prostatic capsule folds on its own and causes folds like this, and you resecting it may expose the make a rent in the prostatic capsule. See that? It's already thinned out prostatic capsule here. You might have just made a rent into the prostatic capsule had it not been very careful. So don't be over jealous in resecting it. These ridges are going to be seen like this, but you resect it and make it flattened, but don't over jealous resection is not advisable. So whenever you start distending or decrease the distension in the bladder, you will see this sort of a more amount of tissue being noticed for you in the prostatic fossa. So your assessment of resection or assessment of the cavity should be only when there is a half resection or a half distension of the prostatic of the bladder, not complete distension of the prostatic of the bladder. See, there is some more tissue in this area which is being resected. There is a lobule here which is being resected, and you see that there is a lobule here. There is a lobule here. So, your assessment of the cavity should always be only when there is a half distension of the bladder, not full distension of the bladder. Now, it is a half full distension, so it everything gets stretched off and you don't feel that as if something is there. But it should be. But at the same time, don't over resect. You may just resect a folded part of the capsule and create more damage to the and open the capsule at one point. Yes, I think I have completed my resection. There's hardly any bleeding there. I need to evacuate the pieces. There's a bleeder which is not there now. I don't see any bleeding anywhere. Small bleeders. This woolly tissue is still adenoma. I can still resect here. Let me be a little careful before. Yes, I finished it. It's not there here. It's not there here. So it's a completeness of the resection. And be careful when you resect at this area. There's no point over jealous here. The sphincter will be very near to the very proximal, so resecting like with a markings on the in the ventral aspect is not correct when you resect dorsally at the dorsum in the roof, I mean to say. Right. So this is the completeness of the resection with everything intact. I don't want to do any more resection now. Okay, helix. The returns are very clear. Need to see that every part of the chip or resected chips are completely evacuated. Chips are being evacuated. Right. After the evacuation, see again whether we see anything inside. Don't expect that the helix has evacuated everything. There may be still small pieces, and these small pieces will block the passage, the catheter in the postoperative period and can cause havoc. Again, see after the end of helix, again see the fossa, especially around the bladder mucosa, cut bladder mucosa, because these are the areas where the vesical varices will be there, which may open up and cause bleeding at that point of time. These are all vesical varices. Again, see at the roof, that is it. Roof is the point where most of the time postoperative bleeders are there. So look at the roof, look at the edge between the prostate and the bladder. And the bladder muscle, that is the area. See if there are any bleeders. If none, you have done a complete resection. Put a two-way, three-way catheter and come out. There is little amount of tissue here. Okay, I'm not interested in taking it out any further now. It appears to be a little lobe which is extending into the capsule. Sometimes it dips deep inside and it may be causing your trouble. An enucleation can be possible easily in these cases, but not a resection, which may be a little difficult in some. So this is the area. Now I don't see any tissue pieces or chips inside. Yes, there's hardly nothing. So I take out my scope. That's a scope which is coming off. I created a little amount of mucosal trauma there. Okay. Xylocaine jelly. And a two-way catheter, three-way catheter being placed into the with a no touch technique. Two 20 cc syringes which are adequate. We don't take 10 cc syringes. Usually don't use this valve too many times. If you use that too many times, it leaks and the catheter may come out. And don't forget not only to withdraw the catheter but also withdraw the skin or they keep the prepuce in place. Otherwise they'll have a postoperative paraphimosis. Take it out and then attach the thing. Take it out. Thank you.